and I'll focus my talk on the role of EUS in pancreatic cysts and what is new. So as you've heard, the reason there's so much to do and interest about pancreatic cysts is because of the malignant potential of some of these cysts. At most, about 0.25% of cysts have invasive cancer at the time of diagnosis, and about a similar percent go on to develop invasive cancer per year during follow-up. And out of all pancreatic cysts, about two-thirds are actually cystic neoplasms, and the majority, as you've heard, are either IPMNs, mucinous cystic neoplasms, serous cyst adenomas, or solid pseudopapillary neoplasms. Now, the key questions to try to answer as best as you can for your patient when you see someone in your office who is, you know, completely freaked out because they were told they have this so-called lesion in their pancreas on CT or MRI, is you want to assess, is the cyst malignant? If you don't believe it's malignant, then what type of cyst is it? As you've heard, is it a mucinous cyst or a non-mucinous cyst? Because mucinous cysts have that malignant potential that most non-mucinous cysts do not. And then finally, what's the likelihood that this cyst will actually move on to develop malignancy? So in terms of diagnosis, really the first step is to get a good quality MRI of the pancreas with MRCP, preferably on a three Tesla MRI if that's available at your institution. And in terms of how accurate it is for detecting malignant cysts, it's about 73 to 91% accurate, similar accuracy for differentiating mucinous from non-mucinous cysts, and as you might expect, not as accurate in telling you exactly what type of cyst the patient has, i.e., do they actually have a serous cyst adenoma or mucinous cystic neoplasm, et cetera. Now, of course, we have EUS-FNA, and it is highly specific for diagnosing malignant cysts, but not very sensitive. And as far as determining if a cyst is mucinous, anywhere from 51 to 75% accurate. I'm just going to say a word about radiology with MRI before spending the rest of my talk on EUS, because much of the way the radiologists approach looking at pancreatic cysts on MRI is the way we do it when we're looking at these cysts on EUS. So first of all, of course, is this lesion even a cyst? And if it is it communicating with the pancreatic duct? Because if that is the case, your differential does get smaller to potentially an IPMN or a pseudocyst. If there's no definite communication seen, if it looks like a microcyst, meaning there's multiple very small cysts within the cyst cavities within the larger cyst, tends to be a serous cyst adenoma, although it can still be a branch duct IPMN, for example. If it appears macrocystic, you have a whole slew of differential diagnoses still left. And then finally, you want to, or the radiologist will be assessing to see if there's any so-called high-risk features, such as mural nodules or main pancreatic duct dilation. So now moving on to EUS. If the patient has presented and you feel they need an EUS, which I'll touch upon in a little bit, how good are we at differentiating if the cyst is mucinous or non-mucinous? And just by using EUS imaging alone, we're not very good. It's about a 51% accuracy. And these are just some representative images. This is a lobular septated lesion with some microcysts as well as macrocysts. This could be a serous cyst adenoma. It could also be a branch duct IPMN. In the middle, you see a very simple unilocular cyst with a thin wall. Could be a mucinous cystic neoplasm, a pseudocyst. You should be able to differentiate those based on the history, as you heard in the previous talk. Less likely to be a branch duct IPMN, but that's still in the differential. And on the right here, this lobular septated cyst, again, could be a branch duct IPMN, even a serous cyst adenoma, less likely to be an MCN. There is low inter-observer agreement for diagnosis of a cyst simply based on the morphology of the cyst. So just looking is not good enough. So that's why there's all this interest. We start sticking needles into everything. So we're, you know, sticking the needle into the cyst. And the first thing I would argue that you should do if you have enough cyst fluid is to assess for the string sign, which is defined as the fluid extending for at least a centimeter, lasting at least a second. If you have this, this is actually highly specific for the cyst being a mucinous cyst. And these are just representative images showing you the string sign, the cyst fluid extending from the tip of the EUS needle here. Again, if you have enough fluid, take a drop, put it in between two of your gloved fingers, spread your fingers apart, and see if you get the string sign. Now, just because you have that doesn't mean you don't send the fluid off for other testing. You should still send it off for other testing, including cyst fluid cytology, which, however, suffers from a rather low sensitivity because there's not that many cells in the cyst fluid itself. So how about FNAing the cyst wall? That does seem to improve diagnostic yield a bit. And the way you do this is once you've completely aspirated the cyst fluid dry and it's collapsed, you go back and forth through the collapse cyst wall with your needle in the hopes that you'll get some of the epithelial cells in the wall of the cyst. And then, of course, CEA. This is from Bill Brugge's seminal study published just over a decade ago now, where he found that cyst fluid CEA level over 192 had a 75% sensitivity and 84% specificity for diagnosing mucinous cysts. However, those are okay numbers, but they're not perfect. And also, one thing to remember is that cyst fluid CEA, the test that we use, has not been validated for use in cyst fluid. And also, the other thing to remember is that levels of cyst fluid CEA do not distinguish between malignant and benign cysts. I know that some of us get worried when we see a cyst fluid coming back as 1,000 or a few thousand. We're thinking, oh my goodness, could this be malignant? But that's not been proven to be the case from studies. And I find this chart to be rather useful in helping us appreciate how imperfect cyst fluid CEA really is. This red line I drew here at about the 192 cutoff, and what you can see is that most of the cysts above 192 are mucinous cystic neoplasms or mucinous cyst adenocarcinomas. However, there are some that are serous cyst adenomas as well as pseudocysts. And the other thing to appreciate here is that the higher the cyst fluid CEA is, the more likely it would be a mucinous cyst rather than serous cyst adenoma or a pseudocyst. And now let's look below 192. Well, here suddenly it could be anything. It could be a mucinous cyst, it could be a serous cyst adenoma, or a pseudocyst. But let's drop the cyst fluid CEA really low, less than 5. And now most of the cysts are pseudocysts or serous cyst adenomas. Very few are mucinous cystic neoplasms, although again, there are some that have cyst fluid levels less than 5. So helpful, you know, but not perfect. And so that's what's led to a lot of the research, including looking at various DNA mutations in the cyst fluid. The best study so far is the KRAS mutation, which, if present, is highly specific for a mucinous cyst, but suffers from rather low sensitivity. What about combining cyst fluid CEA and KRAS? There's not a lot of studies looking at this, but it seems to be that if you combine them, you maintain high specificity. Whether or not this improves sensitivity beyond just the cyst fluid CEA remains a bit unclear, but maybe helpful. And again, as I already discussed, very low CEA levels, highly specific for a serous cyst adenoma or a pseudocyst, as well as a cystic neuroendocrine tumor. Very low levels of amylase, highly specific in excluding pseudocysts. The presence of both KRAS mutation and allelic loss is highly specific for malignant cysts, but again, suffers from low sensitivity. And presence of GNAS mutation is highly specific for an IPMN. So a theme with most of these cyst fluid markers is that if present, they're highly specific for whatever cyst is designed to be diagnosing, but most of these markers suffer from rather low sensitivity. This is a study that we published a couple years ago looking at the Fukuoka, the 2012 Fukuoka guideline, as well as the older original Sendai guideline from 2006. And the question we were asking here was, did performing DNA analysis with KRAS and allelic loss add any significant useful information beyond what we can just get from EUS imaging and cytology in helping us to differentiate malignant from non-malignant cysts? And we found that it did not in our sample. and the Fukuoka guideline performed very well and was superior to the Sendai guideline in diagnosing malignant cysts, mainly because the Fukuoka guideline incorporates cytology now into its algorithm. And these five features I listed to the right are those so-called worrisome or high-risk features that, if present, make you worried about malignancy or malignant transformation, the presence of a nodule, solid component, dilated main pancreatic duct, cyst size over 3 centimeters, and of course concerning cytology. So as you've heard, the presence of mural nodules is a concerning feature that, you know, most all of us agree is a bad thing if present. How good are we at detecting mural nodules? Well, we're not very good. We detect about 40 to 60% of them. EUS does seem to be better than CT at detecting these, and possibly it's better than MRI as well. And this is from a paper from the Mayo group, from Mark Tapazian's group from a few years ago, that I think is great because it defined for us what mucus is versus a nodule. And mucus appears hypoechoic or darker, so here it is, darker compared to the adjacent pancreatic parenchyma, and has a very smooth, well-defined hyperechoic or bright rim around it. So this is a classic picture of a nodule, mucus ball here. And then this is also a mucus ball here, where I hope you can appreciate here it's hypoechoic or darker compared to the adjacent pancreatic parenchyma, has still a very well-defined hyperechoic bright border. So these are both pictures of mucus balls compared to a nodule that appears iso or hyperechoic, seen here compared to the adjacent pancreatic parenchyma. It is not smooth edge and does not have that bright hyperechoic border as seen here, as well as on this image as well. So these are both nodules. Now, can we do better? So there's contrast-enhanced harmonic EUS, where the contrast agent is injected into the patient and helps to visualize the vascularity of nodules, cyst wall, and septa, and presumably may help us better differentiate nodules from mucus. And these are just images from a recent paper looking at this, where this is your typical EUS image, and then following contrast injection, suddenly that disappears, so this is not a nodule, this was mucus. Contrast that to the bottom standard EUS B-mode image, where you see this lesion here, followed by contrast injection, where it actually appears to enhance a bit, and this proved to be invasive cancer. Now, the one thing that I'll point out here is that if you look carefully at this EUS image, I would argue that even without contrast, I would have called this mucus and not a nodule, because based on the paper I just went over from the Mayo group, where mucus appears hypoechoic to the adjacent pancreatic parenchyma, that this looks like, and has a sharp, well-defined border that is bright. And that's what it looks like to me here. So I would have called this mucus, even without the contrast-enhanced imaging. So while this is very cool technology, I think it remains to be determined how, when, and if it will add to what we can currently do right now. Now, in terms of how do you perform EUS FNA, you really need a cyst that's at least a centimeter in size, because if it's any smaller than that, it is very difficult to get enough fluid to send off for any meaningful testing. You typically use a 22-gauge needle, although if it's a large cyst, you can certainly use a 19-gauge needle, so you're not standing there for half an hour waiting for the cyst to drain. Ideally, you want to stick the cyst once and drain it entirely, and then FNA the collapsed cyst wall to send that off for cytology. And this is to try to decrease any potential infectious complications. And as you heard earlier, if there is a nodule or a solid component, definitely target that area with your needle to see if you can find any evidence of malignancy. If you have enough cyst fluid, try to take a drop and assess it for the string sign. Send the rest of it off for cyst fluid CEA and amylase, and potentially KRAS and GNAS. I don't routinely send all my cyst fluid for DNA analysis. If the cyst fluid CEA is very high, and I think it is a mucinous cyst, I won't necessarily send it off unless I'm trying to differentiate if it's an IPMN versus an MCN, in which case I may do the GNAS, because if the GNAS is positive, then I know it's an IPMN. So I do it selectively. And the current societies recommend to administer prophylactic antibiotics. Although this technique is very safe, we published a paper about a decade ago looking at our experience in about 600 EUS FNA of pancreatic cyst patients and found about 2% rate of complications, none of whom needed surgery, and there was certainly no mortality associated with those complications as well. Now, comparing EUS to MRI, they seem, you know, there's not, again, not a lot of studies, but they seem comparable in determining the size of the cyst as well as detecting septa, communication with the main pancreatic duct, and presence of main pancreatic duct dilation. EUS seems to be superior for classifying the specific type of cyst you're dealing with. It may be superior for detecting mural nodules and small masses as well. However, there are certainly limitations of EUS, as we've discussed. It has relatively poor diagnostic accuracy for cytology, even if you are FNAing the cyst wall. Limited sensitivity of most all of our cyst fluid markers. The inter-observer agreement is only moderately good, and that's actually only for solid components. And so in terms of the role of EUS, certainly not every patient who has a cyst needs an EUS. You know, somebody who has a 5-millimeter cyst with no family history of pancreatic cancer does not need an EUS. But if the MRI imaging is inconclusive, you're not sure, for example, if it's a serous cyst adenoma or a branch duct IPMN, EUS may be helpful in that case. Certainly, if there's any signs of worrisome or concerning high-risk features on imaging, I would say EUS should be performed in that case as well. So now, because, as you've seen, the current state of what we're able to do is so imperfect, there's been an explosion of translational research trying to squeeze everything we can out of the cyst fluid, looking at various DNA markers, RNA, protein, and this is just a small sampling of what's been published out there. Up here is this huge panel of DNA mutations published in Gastro. There's a more recent paper in Gut, actually, published this year, looking at whole panels of DNA mutations, and they're very good in terms of, you know, being able to differentiate different types of cysts. And these three that I bolded here is from the recent Gut paper that found that the presence of these three mutations seems to be associated with advanced neoplasia in pancreatic cysts, meaning those cysts that have high-grade dysplasia or cancer, which is certainly of interest because it'd be great if we could figure out who has high-grade dysplasia versus low-grade dysplasia and send those high-grade dysplasia patients off to surgery before they get cancer. Our group, as well as others, have looked at microRNA and its potential utility in differentiating mucinous from non-mucinous cysts, proteomics looking at mucin, metabolomics looking at glucose and kynurenine has been studied as well. The von Hippel-Lindau mutation is associated with serous cyst adenomas as well as VEGF, and then IPMN, I already mentioned GNAS. Our group published a small paper looking at cytokine GCSF and its potential utility in differentiating branch duct IPMNs from mixed or combined type IPMNs as well as main duct IPMNs. But the take-home message right now is that there's a ton of research being done, but none of these are really quite ready for prime time yet. And really much more study and validation needs to be done to figure out what combination of these markers or new different markers will be the best. Now, it's not just cyst fluid, though, that we're looking at. There's also new technology where we can exploit, you know, EUS to use that, one of which is needle-based confocal endomicroscopy. And the technique of this is you need to stick the cyst with a 19-gauge needle, advance this little confocal probe through that 19-gauge needle, apply it gently on the cyst wall, and after injecting fluorescein into the patient, you image the cyst wall. And if you're lucky, you can see this beautiful superficial vascular network, which these white squiggly lines are blood vessels with red blood cells coursing through them. And this was found to be diagnostic for serous cyst adenomas. Not very sensitive for it, though. And the studies have shown anywhere from 3 to 7% rate of pancreatitis, which is higher than the 1 to 2% rate associated with just standard EUS FNA of pancreatic cysts. And this is an example of, again, confocal imaging of an IPMN showing the papillary projections here. Very exciting technology, very cool when you can see this, but really bears further study again to see when and if this technology should be used. And then finally, microbiopsy forceps, the Moire forceps from U.S. endoscopy, where again, you need to use a 19-gauge needle to stick into the cyst. Through that, you advance these tiny forceps through them. They're almost like spy bite forceps. And then once it's advanced out, you open it up, gently push on the cyst wall, have your cystant close, and take a few bites of the cyst wall, hopefully, to get the diagnosis, because, of course, tissue is the issue. So if we can just get that epithelial wall and get a diagnosis, that'd be fabulous. Of course, like most technology, the initial pilot studies have proven to be very promising, but this, again, bears much further study. So just to conclude, it's very important to differentiate mucinous from non-mucinous cysts because of the malignant potential of mucinous cysts. EUS appears comparable to MRI, although it may be superior for detecting mural nodules and small masses. EUS imaging alone is not adequate for diagnosing a cyst, which is why we move on to cyst fluid analysis. However, it still remains flawed, and the best things that we have currently would be the string sign if you have enough cyst fluid to spare a drop, followed by cyst wall cytology, CEA, KRAS, and GNAS. And newer techniques and tools, including molecular cyst fluid markers, contrast, enhanced harmonic EUS, needle-based confocal endomicroscopy, and microbiopsy forceps are certainly exciting, may help, but require a lot further study. Thank you very much for your attention.